Oh, bless the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Won't everyone just take a deep breath and just exhale, exhale. Amen, amen. If you would please, our first scripture, we're going to, in Jeremiah, the 4th chapter, verse 3. Familiar scripture that we have been embracing during this season that we're in. If you would remain standing for the reading of the word, those of you that can. Let us, this is Jeremiah 4:3, please. That's on the, all right, all together. For thus saith the Lord to the men of Judah and Jerusalem, break up your fallow ground and sow not among thorns. And Father, we just bless you for your word today. We thank you, Lord, that it's going to accomplish what you set it out to do. Thank you for your waiting people. Thank you, Father God, Lord, that heaven is touching earth, Lord, and that, God, that you're giving us a revelation, Lord, of who Christ Jesus and who we are in Christ Jesus. Thank you, Father God, for this season that we're in, Lord. Open up our ears that we might hear. Open up our hearts that we might receive, and open up our heart, our eyes, so that we can see. And we just give you glory, honor, and praise for it in Jesus' name. And everyone said, before you seated, why don't you high five three people and tell them, I'm releasing my seat and embracing the process. Seat and embracing the process. And embracing the process. I'm embracing my seed. Releasing my seed and embracing the process. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. We want to get honor to the presence of the Lord in this house, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We give honor to the apostle of this house, none other than Dr. Alonzo T. Gay Sr. Also, we give honor to those of the fivefold, to our mothers, our deacons, our elders, visiting visitors and friends, those that are watching by internet. We just give you, thank God for each and every one of you in your respective places. I want to share with you, if you put the title up there for me, it's a kind of a two-part title. The first slide is, or the second slide, releasing your seed and embracing your process is what we want to share today. We want to share releasing your seed. See that picture, releasing your seed, release it. And embracing the process. Before I get started, I do want to do a recap or introduction just to kind of share what some of the things that we have been hearing as we've been listening to the word that God has given us for this season. We have been praying, and we pray constantly in this house because we want to know the times and season of God. And so we have asked the Lord for the graces of the sons of Issachar, spoken of in the 12th chapter of the book of Chronicles, where 1 Chronicles, the 32nd verse, where it says that they knew the times and they knew what it was that Israel needed to do. And we need to know that whatever we are experiencing, we need to know what God's timing is for that. Amen. And we want to be in his season. It's in the natural. You know, it's kind of chilly outside, it's raining outside. So we needed to get something to cover up with it because that's the season that we're in. Now, you know, we can come out with our bathing suits because we don't go to church with bathing suits. But that is not the season that we're in. We're not on the beach. That's not the position, location we are. But we're in coming to the house of the Lord. So we pray for the right season. And so in praying for the right season, we had gotten an understanding of the importance of being connected and in touch with with the Jewish roots of Christianity. So we connect with the Hebrew calendar, and with it, we have learned to recognize the patterns and order that God has placed in his word, which gives us keys that prophetically align us with the times of his visitation. We need to know what season it is, even as we're talking about seed. If it's not the season to plant watermelon, then you don't want to plant, your seed is not going to flourish. Likewise, when we know what season it is, we know what and how to pray and how to govern ourselves for that season. Does that make sense? So we want to know, we want to be prophetically aligned with heaven so that we can receive a visitation from heaven. Amen. So in this past October of 2016, we entered into the Hebrew year of 5777, which is our 2017, according to the Roman calendar. We also learned in the past teachings that we've been learning the last several years is that the Hebrew language is an ancient language, which means that it uses signs and pictures in order to express itself, and also that not only is it with signs, with pictures, but their letters also stand for what? Numbers, amen. So when we say that this is the year Ayin, we're talking about the number what? 7, absolutely, yes. So we learn that, and we also learn that it is a picture this year of a plow, of a sword, and a weapon, and of course carried over from last year, is which was the letter Vav. Amen. Which was for the 6. We learned last year that it was what? It was a nail. It was a tent peg. Amen. And that it was a connector. And speaking of Vav, I was blessed this week for Brother Tim made a Vav for me. And you know, it's like a tent peg, it's a staff, and it's a connector. Also, we learned that the Vav, the letter last year, was also a comma in the Hebrew grammar and connect sentences. So we learn that some of the things that we're experiencing, we've been putting a period behind it, thinking that was it, when we should have gotten a comma because there was something else to follow. Remember? Amen. So the connector in 2016, as according to the Hebrew, was Jesus Christ, because Jesus Christ connected us to the Father. Amen. He was the connector that when he was on the cross, that he connected heaven to earth by being crucified on the cross, that we have access to heaven. And we learned by tapping into that access that we have the access as king priests, amen, in order to tap into heaven. So the letter Vav is in between 5 and 6. Do anyone remember what the letter 5 was, for the number 5 was? I give you a hint. The wind. Okay. The breath of God. It also meant revelation. So when you connect the Hebrew letters for 5, which was the middle of the decade, right? Which was the hey, right? Remember the little man that was pointing up, behold? Yeah, right. See? So the hey, that was the revelation, the breath of God. Then we have the Vav was the connector. And then the next one is the Zion, which is the 7. So if you were to read it, it would say that the Vav connects the breath, the revelation, amen, of God to the sword, the plow, and the weapon. Because it's a continual journey, according to the Hebrew language and the letters, it's a continual journey. So we know that the Vav was used to attach and reattach some things. Amen. To relay a foundation. If our foundations were shaky, how many know this would hold it down? Glory be to God. I think this is like a railroad nail or something, but it's heavy. But we know that the God we serve is heavy too, amen, and he's able to supersede anything that we might experience, okay? So it's also the year of the crown. So what we found out is this is the Vav, and you see how it's got the little tip on there. But when you look at the Zion goes a little bit longer. It's just like it's actually a crowned Vav. And what it's saying is that when we talk about a crown is something that symbolizes reward. It symbolizes honor. Amen. So in the year last year, whatever struggle you had, whatever pressures that you experienced, whatever disappointments or discouragements, that you held on to the horns of the altar. And because of that faithfulness, you have been crowned. Amen. You have been honored. And you have not only been honored, but you're rewarded. You're going to see the reward of it. That's why we're talking about the seed, because there were seeds that were planted during that time when you were having those challenges, when you were having those disappointments and those times of failure, you felt that you failed, amen. So we, because of the crown that we have, amen, then God crowned us, especially when we learn who we are in Christ. Amen. And so we remember the scripture in 1 Peter 2:9. If we can get that up, we're going to read that too, because it spoke to us in 2016 who we were. Amen. Who we were in Christ. So 1 Peter, the second chapter, verses 9 through 10, and that's in the New King James Version. Very good. Let's read it all together. But you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, his own special people, that you may proclaim the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Why don't you turn to someone and tell them, you're special to God. Turn to someone else and tell them, you're special to me. Amen. Let's give the Lord glory. Hallelujah. And continue on with the crown, because you've been faithful, because you stood, because you may have stumbled along the way, but you didn't fall. And if you fell, you got back up. Hallelujah. Amen. Because we do fall down, but we get up. Amen. Because the Bible says the righteous man falls, what, 7 times. But what happens? He rises up again. He doesn't stay there. We don't have to stay there. You know, we learn. Hallelujah. In Michael 2:10, we learn this is not our rest. Don't stay here, because you're going to get polluted. You're going to get stuck. You're going to get stagnant. I want to share with you something that kind of grabbed a hold along the way. We're talking about the crown. If we would look at John, the 19th chapter, verses 19 through 22 in King James Version. We're going to read that all together. All together. And Pilate wrote a title and put it on the cross. And the writing was, Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews. Then many of the Jews read this title, for the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Hebrew, Greek, and Latin. Therefore, the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate, "Do not write the King of the Jews," but he said, "I am the King of the Jews." Pilate answered, "What I have written, I have written." So you see, they put a crown on Jesus in mockery, but in actuality, and then they put the name on there. They wanted to put, he said he was the King of the Jews, but Pilate said, no, exactly what is written on there, the King of the Jews. So what you see is Pilate was a heathen, but yet it was the religious people were saying, change that sign. Put on there that he said he was the King of the Jews. But Pilate, an authority figure, told them, no, write down what I said. See, the enemy's always trying to take our crown. He's always trying to take our rewards. He's always trying to take those things that bring honor to us. And the enemy will try to take our crown. If he try to take Jesus' crown and try to take his name off and put it the way the religious people said it, then how many know that it's going to happen to us? That the enemy tries to take our crown. Sometimes feeling of unworthiness will try to take our crown. Sometimes feelings of guilt and shame might try to take our crown. This is what God has crowned us with, what he wants to bless us with, that he wants to let us know that you're being rewarded for your faithfulness. You're being rewarded for your diligence. You are being rewarded for your commitment. Amen. But sometimes that fear and intimidation will try to rob us of that crown. Our authority figure has already spoken the word of the Lord over us. He's already told us what God has spoken to us about our future. And yet we get intimidation. We allow inferiority. We allow doubt and unbelief to rob us of the crown that God wants to reward us with. He wants to bless us. The Bible said, "Fear not, little children, for it is the Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom." In his kingdom, there's no lack. In his kingdom, there is healing and wholeness. There is nothing missing and nothing broken in his kingdom. And we are kingdom people. God has called us to be kingdom people and to execute the things of the kingdom here on earth. Somebody give him glory today. So we got to shut out the voices of the naysayers. We got to shut out the voices of those that don't want you to prosper, those that don't want you to have anything. Shut out the voices of those that would try to rob us of our crown. And most of all, the greatest voice that we need to shut out is our own voice. The voices within us. I remember reading one time this cartoon by a Pogo cartoon, and he was saying, we have found the enemy, and it's in us. So sometimes it's our own voice that we need to shut up and stop listening to, amen? So we don't want to let the enemy to remove our crown, because what God has rewarded you with for your faithfulness is yours. What God has for you is yours, amen? I want you to say this after me. I'm crowned, I'm rewarded, and honored. Turn to your neighbor behind you and tell them, I'm sowing my seed. And embracing the process. Let's give God glory today. Hallelujah. So the letter Vav is a six, right? And six represents what? The number of what? The number of man. Amen. It's the number of man. So God is saying, I'm crowning man. I want to crown man. Amen. In this time that we're in. Glory be to God. Amen. So when we look at those things that God has spoken to us before, it's so important that we hold on to those things. Amen. And realize, yes, there is a process. But God, Jesus is the connector. He's the one that's able to connect us to our promise. Amen. We also believe and have been preaching and hearing the messages, and we've been praying because we believe that it's a season that God is plowing up our fallow ground. Amen. We know that our main scripture for this season comes out of the book of what? Hosea. Amen. Chapter 10, verse 12. We know that. We should know that by heart, right? Sow to yourself in righteousness, reap in mercy. Break up your fallow ground, for it is time to seek the Lord till he come and rain righteousness upon you. See, a lot of things that we are seeing and experiencing, the chaos that's happening in this world, because the people aren't seeking God. They're seeking answers through man, through programs, okay, through different governmental areas or things like that. They're seeking help. But God said, this is a time we got to seek the Lord. I was talking to someone the other day, and they were not too happy about the election. They were saying, man, I got to pray. I said, you know what? You're right where God wants you at. You need to pray. Because if we were praying like we're praying for our current president, like we did for the past president that pushed through the abortions, that pushed through the gay marriages, that pushed through all those things that would cause a nation to fall, then some of those things might not have passed. But I'm glad you're praying. Amen. Keep on praying. Because I believe that's one of the reasons why we're experiencing what we're experiencing. Because we weren't praying. And now we see the fruit of it. But that's okay. That's not, you know, God has the last word. Amen. So we are praying for the rain to water our seed. And so Dr. Gay is going to share with that later, the rain of righteousness, amen, in his messages. But I want to put up a slide from a prophetic word from Phyllis Ford. She's not very popular, but we have extracted some of the things that she has spoken in the past. And we have slides 4, 5, and 6 that share the three prophetic segments that she mentioned about in the next 5 months. And I had shared them before, but I wanted to put them up in case anyone that takes notes want to write some down. So the first segment that we talked about was the Jewish New Year, which is called what? Rosh Hashanah. Don't be afraid. We've been learning this for 7 years. Okay. So Rosh Hashanah is what? It's a time of adjustment as we walk in what? His purpose, adjustments in plans, purpose, and position. Adjustments in what? Plans, purpose, and position. So we got to be open to adjustment. And I know that some of the things that I've been hearing, that people have been experiencing adjustments in their plans. They have experienced adjustments in their positions, and they have been experiencing adjustments in the purpose. What we thought God's purpose was for us, God has made some adjustments. Amen. So this year, up until this year, first of the year, was a time of adjustment. And the next segment, segment number two, is January the 1st, 2017, and it's what? A time of recalibration, resuscitation, and replenishing. So recalibration, you know, we have to recalibrate something when it gets off offline. And resuscitation, we need to have more air, more oxygen, more energy, amen. And a replenishing, replacing some things that perhaps have been lost in the times that we have experienced in the past. And then we put that next slide up, please. And this is segment three. And let's read that. And this is supposed to start March 9th. And we do the seven main feasts. So the Feast of Purim is not one of our feasts, but it is, one of the ones that we study. But we connect, that's connected with the Book of Esther. So if you get a chance to read the Book of Esther, you know there are a lot of shifting that takes place with that. You know, in Esther, here she was getting into the position of queen. But before that, she didn't know what to do, but she asked a person that represent the Holy Spirit, which was the eunuch that was in charge, because who would know, who would be closer to the king to know what he liked. And so she asked, so she knew, so she would know how she needed to present herself before the king. Some of us need to ask and not ask down, okay? Don't ask Pookie and them who are down there and they don't want to go anywhere. They don't want nothing. They ain't got nothing. They don't want anything. Don't ask them. But you need to ask up someone that's been where you're going and ask them what you need to do to prepare. And don't be afraid if it cuts against the flesh, because that will heal also. Amen. So Esther became queen. She was in a position that she was not, she never thought she would be in. And it was a scary position, but it was spoken to her by her uncle Mordecai that, you know, you have been called for such a time as this. We got to know what we've called to be and where we need to be. And we need to stop flip-flopping here and there and not getting anything, because we need to give glory to God in what we do. Our purpose is not about us, okay? It's not about us. It's about God. And we got to keep that in mind when we talk about the things of the kingdom, amen? So we see that third slide, that it is that the month of March during the Feast of Purim. Let's read that again. It's a time what? For those who are ready for the next phase of growth, a time of reordering, renewing, and repairing of the breach, healing that which has been broken. So these are things that you can claim, these things you can pray, these are things that you can hold on to, that know that something is going to happen, amen? So I wanted to just share briefly some of those things. And you know, in April, we're going to be starting talking about the spring feast. And so we'll also carry some, you know, catch up with some more things in the past and recap. But I want to share with you what the Lord had placed in my heart for the message today: releasing your seed and embracing the process. When you look at the definition for the word release, means to set free from restraint, to give up in favor of another, to relinquish. Relinquish means to give up your rights. When we talk about a seed, because we're releasing our seed, it's the beginning of something which continues to develop or grow. It's not going to happen overnight. Amen. And then the next thing is embrace. So we're going to release the seed, and then we're going to embrace it. And we're going to do a little illustration. We can get ready for our illustration now. The word embrace means to accept something or someone readily or gladly. So it speaks of our attitude. When we're talking about embracing something, it's talking about our attitude. And another part of the definition means to use opportunity eagerly. When opportunity comes, are you quickly ready to shoot it down and say why it can't happen? Or do you take a time and ask the Holy Spirit, what does he say about it? What is his answer to the opportunity that's being opened for me? Because this is the time of shifting. We got to be ready to shift when God says shift. So this is our illustration. The Lord gave me again, I've done this a couple times, the past, present, and the future, but he keeps giving me different things to add to that. So we're going to get started with our illustration.
Praying for your mate. You must walk in that faith. And you must walk together in it.
Faith. God's going to send me the perfect mate. Yes. I'm holding on to that.
You know you ain't going to find that man at church. You know Mr. Sebastian?
Praying, sowing seeds for your healing. Now you must walk in that faith of healing as you are healed.
I am healed by faith. I am healed.
Yeah. Woo. Yeah. Hallelujah.
You talking about that same knee you blew out in high school? You know it's raining outside, right?
These seeds financially, pay your tithes, you're faithful to go to church, you're faithful to do what you are asked of in church.
Yes. My financial blessing is on the way.
Amen.
Financial release is on the way. So excited.
But what about that letter from your bank that said the way your bank account is set up?
Jesus.
But woman of God, you've been sowing seeds and asking God what you're calling in. You've got to walk in it. You've got to believe for it.
Walk in my calling. Believing. My calling, my spiritual destiny. My kingdom destiny is here. Oh, I'm excited. So excited. Kingdom.
Procrastinator. You keep running from it. Keep running. Come on. Keep running from it.
Woman of God, have faith, and we'll journey off together.
I've sown my seeds. I'm embracing the process. I'm heading towards my future.
Let's go.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The Lord spoke to me in prayer. He said, when you release your seed, you can't get too attached to it or it won't grow to bring forth a harvest. So some of us need to get on our computers and we need to go to letgo.com and we need to release some things that's holding us back, amen, from releasing our seed. So I have a picture up here of a little seeding. Just to kind of go a little bit with the process that a seed goes through. That's why if you sowed your seed, don't expect to have it come forth the next day or even the next week. But there is a process that the seed goes through. Amen. Let's read that germination process up there. It says, germination is what? The growth of a plant contained within a seed. Seed germination depends upon both internal and external conditions. So I have... depending on the seed, the process could be shorter or longer. And then different seeds have different things that they need. This happens to be a bean seed, and we're pretty familiar with beans down here. Glory be to God. But I want to share five processes and just how you connect them spiritually when you talk about a natural seed. First of all, the first stage that it goes through is imbibition. And this is the physical process when the seed, which is dead, takes on water. So the seed begins to absorb the water, which causes it to swell. When we think about water, what does that remind us of in the spirit? The Holy Spirit, amen. So as we take on the promises of the Holy Spirit, and you know, like we sang that song, that last song, when the Spirit of the Lord comes upon us and the things that we begin to do because the Spirit of the Lord has come upon us, that there's a swelling that takes place. Because you may have came in and you may not have been feeling very well, or you may not have gotten some good news or anything, but you came in and the presence of the Lord came and you begin to swell. Your faith began to swell, and that you were able to begin to break through whatever might have tried to hold you down, whatever tried to weigh you down or try to cause a heaviness to come upon you. So there's, when we read and absorb God's word, it causes our faith to swell. And how many know when our faith swells, then whatever hard place that we might be in, we're able to break out of it, amen. So they're able to break out of it. And the word God says that faith comes what? By hearing, and hearing what? By the word of God. And that word is a sword, amen. So the word of God causes faith to well up in us. And I'm reminded that Deacon Neil ministered one Sunday in May of last year, and he said this. He said, the seed of your struggle becomes the fruit of your season. The seed of your struggle becomes the fruit of your season. So the seed struggles, the seed pushes out, amen, in order to be able to get what it needs. Whatever you need to know that there's a breaking forth that needs to take place. There's a pushing out. We got to push past the naysayers. We have to push past the voices of the past that would try to rob us of our blessing, or would cause us, our seed, not to be able to germinate, not to be able to grow and to bring forth fruit. So that we learned also that the ground represents what? The condition of our heart, amen, and that seeds cannot grow in hard ground, because the seed has to absorb not only the water, but the oxygen and the nutrients of the ground. And if the ground is hard and dried up, then the seed is not going to flourish. Does it make sense why God cannot cause the seed that you planted to go forth? Because if your heart's hardened, if you have anger in your heart, if you have discouragement in your heart, whatever you have that you have not released to God, amen, so that seed can flourish, that there's a hindrance there, amen. So a lot of times, you know, we have to try to understand that we are to sow seeds of righteousness to ourselves, amen. So sometimes when we, you know, get into that hard place, we want somebody to feel sorry for us. But we need to be like Donald Trump. We need to say, you're fired. To the pity party, amen. Tell the pity party, you're fired. I'm not going to convene anymore. I'm not going to look for people to feel sorry for me. And maybe if they feel sorry for me, maybe I can pull them in to do something for me that I should be doing for myself. Hello, somebody. Amen. Sympathy will not help your seed to grow. Amen. Amen. Also, when we talk about that seed that's that I showed a picture of, you can put the picture back up for me, please, is that the seed needs light. There's two types of seeds as far as the light. First of all, there's one that's photoblastic, which is positive, and there's negative. And I'm reminded that those that are positive are the ones that grow from the light. The negative grows in darkness. So, you know, in the decade that we're in, the iron decade, right? We have that ability to see things two ways, right? Positively or negatively. Same thing when it comes to our seed. We can either see our seed in a negative way or we can see it in a positive way. Turn to someone and tell them, I'm releasing my seed and embracing the process. Another phase, the fourth phase that seed goes through, is called mobilization of reserves during seed germination. During this time, the embryo, and it's interesting that the seed is called an embryo, just like in human beings, the embryo seed goes through division and expansion as it receives nutrition. Stored starch, protein, or fats need to be digested at this time. We need to have reserves for our seeds that we are sowing to make it through the process. And you know, I say all the time, when it's a time of peace, that's when you're supposed to prepare for war. You don't try to load your gun while you're in the midst of the battle and somebody's shooting at you. You need to have that gun loaded before you go into battle. So you do things in order to store up. Because I don't know about you, but a lot of time when I'm going through things, I'm not feeling real deep and spiritual. But if I've already spent time with the Lord and I prayed and I read my word and I've gotten that foundation built up in me, then even though I may not feel up to it, it's in me. I have reserves within me. I'm able to pull on what is in me in order to flourish. And that's why we got to mobilize, amen. We got to come to Bible study. We got to read our word on a regular basis, you know, be here on Sunday mornings and whatever activities or whatever guest speakers that we have, you need to try to find your way here because everything goes together for the season that we're in. It gives us everything we need for that season. So we don't wait until we get a problem. Don't wait to fast and pray when you feel like somebody's after you. Yeah, somebody's doing something to me, so I better start fasting. Well, you need to have a consecrated life all the time before the Lord. Don't get consecrated when the hellhounds are on your back, but you need to live a consecrated life so that when God asks for fruit, guess what? You're able to give it. You don't have to go and pray, you know, and read 10 chapters before you feel like you can share some fruit with somebody, but that fruit should always be there. And I was talking to someone the other day, and they were sharing how, you know, people come to them for prayer and the things that they're going through. And I said, you know what? I've experienced it all my life is that whatever I was going through, it seemed like the same thing I was going through, people would come to me that wanted prayer for that same thing. That's why it's so important that we don't call a pity party, that we don't expect someone else to feel sorry for us. You know, a lot of times people get on Facebook and tell you their business, but they can't pick up the phone and say, you know what, Elder, I need prayer. I'm going through something. You don't know that you don't know they're going through anything unless you're on Facebook. And then, you know what, that church don't care nothing about anybody. You know, I was going through and nobody called me or said anything. You know, they're a prophetic church. God should have told them if they listen to God. Yeah, God told us in our word, if there be any sick among you, do what? Call for the elders of the church. So we got to mobilize our reserves during that time that your seed is being germinated. And you know what? We not only should store up the Logos word, which is the written word, but we need to store up the Rhema word. Those things that have been spoken to us. If you haven't got a journal for your prophetic words, you need to get them off those CDs or those cassettes, and you need to write them down, because even as you write them down, God will continue to minister to you about it. Or if you're feeling down and you don't feel like praying, then you read what God has already spoken to you about. Amen. Read his Logos word, but his written word also is that timely word that we need for that time that we're in. So mobilization of reserves during the time that your seed is germinating. Amen. I mean, releasing my seed and embracing the process. And the last thing is the development of the embryo axis into a seedling. If I can see the picture again, if you look at that as the progression, you see the seed to where it's just the seed, and then you see how it has the sprout goes forth in the primary root and then the secondary root. And you see that as it develops, now it started out with a seed, but look at the end, it's a plant. So there's that last development where you see the harvest, where you see the seedling, they call that comes forth, that which grows out of it. So after the translocation of the food and its subsequent assimilation, you're assimilating the prophetic word. You're assimilating the word that's being in the Bible. You're assimilating the word that's being spoken over the pulpit. Amen. It says the seeds, the cells of the embryo in the growing regions become metabolically very active. See, we'll get out active. We'll get off our blessed assurance when we have, when we mobilize our reserves and begin to allow God to stir that those things up in us. No matter what it is that we're believing God for, when we have the ability, when God begins to call that growth to take place, we're like Jeremiah. It's like fire shut up in our bones. We got to tell somebody about Jesus. We got to tell somebody of his faithfulness. We got to tell somebody of how I made it through and how God helped me to make it through. So the seedling in the young plant that develops out of a plant embryo from a seed, and we remember that Dr. Gay shared with us that whatever process that you're going through, that we must be prepared to bring forth fruit when God requires it of us. Amen. So I want to look at a scripture in St. Luke, amen. And I want to remind you that as we get prepared for that scripture in Luke 8, 5 through 15, we're going to read that together, that I share with you years ago, and every once in a while I'll tell you in the teaching, that in this decade that we pay attention to the book of Luke, that Luke's name means giver of life. And that when you read the book of Luke, look for a revelation. Look for something to jump out at you, something that will speak to you that never spoke to you before. Amen. And so when the Lord gave me this, the book of Luke, it just blessed me because it connects with what we're talking about today. We're talking about our seed. Amen. So when we look at this decade that we're in, the decade of the eye, that it tells us that we're going to gain more prophetic insight. Expect it. Lord, I'm open. I want a prophetic insight. You know, and when we begin to say that to ourselves and say, Lord, I want you to give me more prophetic insight, he'll give it to you. But he's not going to give it to you if you don't ask. Amen. Because he's not a violator. He's only going to, when you open yourself and open up your heart and you surrender to him, say, Lord, I want to know what it is that you need for me to know in this season. So we're to get prophetic insight and to see those things we have not been able to see before, what? In the light of today. So that is in Luke, the book of Luke, Luke the doctor, Luke the disciple. His name is a Greek name. It means light giving or giver of light. So look, you know, we need light in order to see, right? All right. So let's read that together. Luke 8, 5 through 15. A sower went out to sow his seed. And as he sowed, some fell by the wayside, and it was trodden down. And the fowls of the air devoured it, and some fell upon a rock. And as soon as it was sprung up, it withered away, because it lacked moisture. And some fell among thorns, and the thorns sprang up with it and choked it. And other fell on good ground, and sprang up, and bare fruit an hundredfold. And when he had said these things, he cried, he that hath ears to hear, let him hear. And his disciples asked him, saying, what might this parable be? And he said, unto you it is given to know the mysteries of the kingdom of God, but to others in parables, that seeing they might not see, and hearing they might not understand. Now the parable is this. The seed is the word of God. Those by the wayside are they that hear. Then cometh the devil and taketh away the word of their hearts, lest they should believe and be saved. They are on the rock, are they, which when they hear, receive the word with joy. And these have no root, which for a while believe, and in time of temptation fall away. And that which fell among thorns are they which, when they have heard, go forth and are choked with cares and riches and pleasures of this life and bring no fruit to perfection. But that on the good ground are they which, in an honest and good heart, having heard the word, keep it and bring forth fruit with patience. Let me pause for a minute and say this. The person that sower, he wouldn't be called a sower if he wasn't used to sowing. So he sowed the seed on all different grounds. Amen. The God that we serve, he has no respect of persons. The word of God tells us that while we were without strength, Christ died for our sins. He died on the cross for us that whosoever will, let him come. And so no matter where you might find yourself, you might find some things have been choked out of your life. You might find that you're on rocky ground, or you might find that the seed was sowed and you were excited, but something happened that caused you to begin to lack faith. See, I heard a preacher saying, I think it was Franklin Graham, he said, it wasn't the giants that kept the children of Israel out of the promised land. It was the 10 voices. See, there were two voices that were of God, Caleb and Joshua. They spoke the word of God. They spoke faith. But there were 10 that overshadowed, they were the majority that spoke doubt and unbelief. Turn to your neighbor and say, what voices are talking to you? Because it's the voices that rob us of our promises. That's why Dr. Gay told us to guard our hearts, protect our hearts. Because those voices begin to shout louder than God's voice. Because God's voice is what? It's not in the thunder. It's not in the wind. But it's what? The still, small voice. So our voice is louder sometimes. That's what we got to say, shut up. Self. See, a lot of time we blame the devil. We give the devil a lot of advertisement. Free advertisement. It ain't the devil. It's our own voice. The devil don't have to say anything to us. We sabotage ourselves because of those of our feelings. We'll let our feelings. No, it don't feel right. Well, I don't always feel saved. But that don't keep me from living saved. Because it ain't about my feelings. It's about faith. So it's those voices. If you can get a hold of them voices and realize that it's not the giant. It might look, what you're challenged with might look like a giant. That seed that you sowed, it might look like a giant as far as, I don't know if it'll come to pass because, you know, nobody else has done this or I haven't seen anyone else do. It's not that seed because God can handle the seed. He got the giants. God's got the giants. But we the only ones that can shut up the voices. Give God glory today. Hallelujah. That last verse in Luke chapter 8, it says, but that on the good ground are they which in an honest and good heart, having heard the word, keep it and bring forth fruit with patience. Now, I put it in Dr. Gay's favorite translation. We know that is what? The Message Bible. Let's read that in the Message Bible. Luke 8:15. It says, but the seed in the good earth, these are the good hearts who seize the word and the sword, amen, and hold on no matter what, sticking with it until there is a harvest. Give them glory. Hallelujah. I want everyone to stand to your feet. Turn to someone and tell them, I'm releasing my seed and embracing the process. One of the things that I heard in the message last week, with Deacon, I think it was Deacon Neal, he said, stop complaining and start declaring. And we're going to declare his word. I got several scriptures I'm put up there. We're going to declare his word. The first part, we're going to declare who Christ is. In the next section, we're declaring who we are. And then we're going to declare God's promise. Amen. Say it again. I'm releasing my seed.
I'm releasing my seed.
And embracing the process. Hallelujah. Let's get our first scripture. Isaiah 53:2 all together. For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant and as a root out of a dry ground. He hath no form nor comeliness. And when we shall see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him. 2 Timothy 2:8. Remember that Jesus Christ of the seed of David was raised from the dead according to my gospel. Romans 1:3. Concerning his son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, which was made of the seed of David according to the flesh. John 7:42. Hath not the scripture said that Christ cometh of the seed of David and out of the town of Bethlehem where David was? Hebrews 2:6. For verily he took not on him the nature of angels, but he took on him the seed of Abraham. Hallelujah. Give him glory. The next couple of scriptures, let's declare who we are. Galatians 3:29. And if ye be Christ, are you Christ? Yes. All right. If ye be Christ, then are ye Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. Hallelujah. Let's declare God's promise to us out of Isaiah 59, verses 19, 20, and 21. Before we get started, let's declare it again. I'm releasing my seed. And embracing the process. I am from the seed of Abraham. Hallelujah. All right, let's say it all together. So shall they fear the name of the Lord from the west, and his glory from the rising of the sun. When the enemy shall come in like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord shall lift up a standard against him. Are you being flooded? Anybody being flooded today? Anybody being overwhelmed, aggravated, agitated? The Spirit of the Lord will lift up a standard against it. Verse 20, and what will happen? And the Redeemer shall come to Zion, and to them that turn from transgression in Jacob, saith the Lord. And verse 21, as for me, this is my covenant with them, saith the Lord. My spirit that is upon thee and my words which I have put in thy mouth shall not depart out of thy mouth, nor out of the mouth of thy seed, nor out of the mouth of thy seed's seed, saith the Lord, from henceforth and forever. Hallelujah. Say, I'm releasing my seed and embracing the process. I'm releasing my seed and embracing the process. Now, this is what we're going to do. We're just going to do some quick prayer activation. I want you to couple up with one other person, and we're going to pray some of these things as far as the processing of the seeds. And remember those Acts ministries. Please make sure you join with our guests and visitors. Hallelujah. Quickly. Two. All right. Elder Sam, will you make sure everybody's got two and two? Amen. We're not doing no three, no ring around the rose, anything like that. Just two. Hallelujah. All right. Amen, amen, amen. All right, everybody got somebody? All right, don't be like the little Italian woman that said, everybody got to somebody, but nobody, I don't have got to nobody. All right. The first thing we're going to do is just pray in the Holy Ghost. If you in your heavenly language, if you don't pray in the Holy Ghost, just say, thank you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. Bless my sister. Bless my brother. Building yourself up in your most holy faith, according to Jude the 20th verse, praying in the Holy Ghost. 3, 2, 1. And everybody said, amen. Now, this is what we're going to pray. We're going to pray for their breakthrough, for their seed to break through, that whatever's hindering them, that it be removed, and they will have free reign to break through whatever it is that's causing a barrier between them receiving their promise. So, Father, right now, in the name of Jesus, I lift up my brother and I lift up my sister, and I thank you for your word that's come forth, Lord, that we're able, Father, to release our seed. So whatever is hindering my brother or my sister from releasing their seed, seed, Lord. I stand in agreement with them, Lord, that they will experience breakthrough, Lord, that you're breaking up the fallow ground, Lord, and they're going to absorb everything that they need in order for that seed to grow. I thank you, Father God, that breakthrough is their portion, that you release them, Father God, Lord, from any areas of fear, Lord, that you release them, Father, from any giants, Lord, that might be trying to harass them and torment, Lord, that you release them from them voices that would try to discourage them, that would try to keep them, Father God, Lord, from standing in faith, that, Lord, that you will cause them, Father God, to break out of the past, Lord, the past, Lord, that causes them to think that they can't make it, that they're unworthy, that caused them to believe, Lord, that they're going to fail, Lord, cause them to believe, Lord, that they've done too much and that you're not able to forgive them, Lord, that you're not able, Lord, to embrace them, Lord, but in Jesus' name, Lord, that your truth will cause them to be set free, Lord, that as I pray for my brother and sister, Lord, that breakthrough, Lord, is their portion. Breakthrough is coming, Lord. Their seed is going to break through and it's going to receive, Lord, the nourishment that it needs in order to grow and to bring forth fruit. I thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. Thank you, Father God, in Jesus' name, Lord, that you will cause it to break through. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. And everybody said, amen. All right, let's switch. Let's switch and find someone else quickly. We're going to pray just like we pray for ourselves. We're going to pray for one another. Amen. And this second thing we're going to pray for, we pray for their seed to break through. Now we're going to pray that it's going to absorb everything that God wants them to have in order for that seed to grow. Everything, that if there's a deaf and dumb spirit that's trying to hinder them, that God would open up their ears and open up their heart. So let's begin to pray now. Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we thank you, Father God, Lord, for their breakthrough. And now, Lord, we're praying that everything that they need to absorb in order to for their seed to flourish, that it will happen, Lord. That, Lord, anything that's blocking their mind, that, Lord, those things, Lord, that might be stopping their ears, those things that may be blinding them to your truth, Lord, I thank you, Father, that you will arrest those things, Lord, that in the name of Jesus, Lord, that you will cause them, Father God, to absorb everything, every truth that you have for them, that you will break any stronghold, Father, that will cause them, Lord, not to be able to absorb your word, Lord, and understand your word and the revelation of your word, Lord. Those hindrances that will keep them, Father God, Lord, from experiencing your spirit, Lord, touching them and blessing them, Lord. Cause them, Father God, Lord, to be hindered, Lord, from receiving all that you have for them, Lord. I thank you, Lord, that the roots will go deep for them, Lord, that the roots will absorb everything that you want them to absorb, that they need to absorb in the name of Jesus. I thank you, Father God, Lord. I declare it and decree it, Father, in Jesus' name, Lord, that as I pray for my brother and my sister, Lord, that they will experience everything that you have for them. Absorb it, Lord. They will get fat, Lord. They will grow and flourish in the things of God. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. And everybody said, amen. One more time. Let's give God glory. Repeat after me. I'm releasing my seed and embracing my process. One more time. Get one more person. One more person. This is the last one. We're going to pray. Because the seed needs light. The seed needs light. So we pray that their way will be lit. And they will be able to see what God is doing. And they'll be able to embrace it. In Jesus' name. So we're praying for light. For them to be able to see what God is doing. All right. Everyone ready? All right. Begin to pray now. Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, as I lift up my brother, I lift up my sister, I'm praying, Lord, for the light of your love, Lord, to lead their way, Lord, that you will cause their eyes to see what they have not been able to see before, Lord, that in the name of Jesus, Lord, that you will light their pathway, Lord, that you will remove the scales off their eyes, and they'll be able to see, Father God, you high and lifted up in every situation and circumstance, that they can see, Lord, the way that you have for them to walk, and they will walk in the name of Jesus, Lord. I thank you once again for breaking up the fallow ground, Lord. I thank you once again for causing them to experience the light of your love, the light of your love, Lord, that will light the way for them, light the way, Lord, and cause their seeds to flourish, cause their seed, Father God, Lord, to respond, Lord, cause the growth, Lord, cause the harvest to take place, Lord, cause them, Father God, Lord, to see you in a new light, Lord, cause them to see those things they have not been ever seen before in the light of the day, Lord. Thank you, Father God, Lord, for breaking open that seed, Lord. God, thank you, Lord, for feeding that seed, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for lighting the way for that seed. And we give you glory and honor for you. And in Jesus' name, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. And everybody said, amen. Hallelujah. Give God glory. Say, I'm releasing my seed. I'm releasing my seed and embracing the process. Releasing my seed and embracing the process. Hallelujah. You may be seeing the presence of the Lord. Hallelujah. Hold on to your hopes.
This is what the Lord spoke to me, and I shared with Deacon Neal, who was back there. The Lord said, let your request be made known to him. He's not like man that he will lie. He put the words out there so he have to honor his word. He said, put me in remembrance of my word. And it, so when you let your, and he said, and when you let your request be made known, he said, come to me. And he says, now, this is what he spoke to me. You asked for it. Now I got to develop you in it so you can receive it.
Wow.
I got to develop you so that you can receive it.
Jesus.
Have you ever witnessed that people, and you see it, and you hear they're on the television, they have hit the lottery. You hear it all the time. Yeah. They hit the lottery. And because they wasn't developing process to know how to handle wealth, they had it today and tomorrow it was gone.
Yeah.
Come on now. Did you ever hear that before?
Yeah.
And I can share with you concern about myself. Glory be to God. When I made $100, man, I mean, I thought I was rich back in the day. And I didn't have, other words, my mentality had not been processed. So I had that money and I didn't know what to do with it. But what I did, I tried to satisfy something in me. And once I tried satisfied and once I satisfied, I found myself broke. Why? Because I wasn't processed to be able to handle wealth. Well, it's not only with wealth, but even in relationship. Oh, man, I'm talking to somebody right now. Okay, you want your relationship to get better with your mate, with your family members, or with your co-workers. The Lord say, okay, I got to develop you so that you can handle it. I got to develop you to get. So I like what you were saying. Glory, I mean, that is so powerful. What your text was again?
The text?
Yeah. That same thing, text okay. And title. Same.
I'm releasing my seed and embracing the process.
I mean, you really have to embrace the process. How many know how to ride a bicycle? But when you first start learning, you really had to embrace that bicycle. You embrace with all your life, with all your strength, because you didn't want to fall. But we fall down. But you got right back up. And you embraced that bicycle and you started again until you begin to learn the nature, until you was processed. It wasn't the bicycle. It was you being processed to learn how to have control over it. Come on, I'm sowing my seed and embracing the process. Oh, I'm getting ready to sit down here. So once you embrace, amen, the process, as the Lord was processing you to ride that bicycle, then glory be to God, you was able to ride that bicycle and take your hand off it and just be going around a curve. You didn't have to put your hands on the handlebar. You just, come on now, just. Come on now, come on, come on, come on. So the bicycle wasn't the problem. The seed is not the problem. The Lord said, I'm processing you. Hey, Lord.
Dr. Gay, the seed is not the problem because the seed is dead.
Right. And you know, watch, the seed is dead. You know what? Let me tell you something. My brother can tell you this, and all of us who have did a little sharecropping and watch this. Sometime I watch my grandfather and my uncle after they have a harvest. It might be black-eyed peas. It might be crowder peas. It might be, oh, Lord, it might be field peas. It might be purple hulls and so forth and so on. I can feel it coming on. But watch this. They will dry out. They'll let the seed dry out in the hull. Come on now. And then they will get us. They put it in a croaker sack, and we had to take a stick and beat the croaker sack. I'm going somewhere. And then we had to separate the seed from the hull. And watch this now. You said something. Sometime the seed that you're going to plant may have a little spot on it. But that don't hinder the process. Because it's not the spot that you want to grow. It's what's inside the seed. Look at your neighbor and say, stop beating yourself up. It's what's inside the seed. Well, God, I don't feel like it. He said, it's not in the feel like it. It's what I put inside you. Oh.
Glory be to God.
Lord, I don't feel like I'm saved. Lord, I don't feel like I'm the best mate or the best employee or the best this and the best that. That ain't what he's sowing. It's the seed that's on the inside of you, that little nucleus. So we witness a little spot that's on the seed. You go, boy, don't throw that thing away. You sow it, man, put it inside that, in that cedar and pull it, and man, up come the bean. Up come the peas. Whatever it is, begin to grow. Because we're not growing spots.
Yeah. The seed grows from the inside
out. The seed grows from the inside out. That's why it's an inside job.
That's right. It's an inside job.
The Lord talking to you. Wasn't that, that was a powerful teaching, wasn't it? Come on now. Let's thank God for the message and for the messenger. Come on now, give the Lord some praise. You ought to run with that. My God. Very, very powerful. I want you to prepare your heart now. I hear the Lord speaking. Get your best seed together outside of your tithe and offering. And sow into what the Lord has said. No, you're not buying nothing. You're just acclimating. You're releasing your faith because God is going to do in you what you can't do in yourself. And you know, we're not a ministry, we're not a church that pull for money. Nobody can say that we pull for money. But when the Lord do speak, we share it. You sow your best seed. Because we're sowing seed.
And embracing the process.
Watch this. She said, embracing the process, you got to have patience.
Yeah.
This is why old structures is crumbling.
Jesus.
And you feel like you're out of control, and the Lord is bringing you into a new structure. Why? Because you got seed in the ground. And heaven is touching earth with rain. And there's a new structure. There's a new manifestation of God's Spirit to give you what you're looking for. It's a process. I remember years and years ago, I've seen where three generations was raised in the same apartment. And that mindset, we witnessed God break that mindset. And they was able to get their own apartment. I witnessed generations who've never had transportation, they had to rely on family members. How many of them that can be aggravated? You ought to get your license. But we witness people who have never had a car before, they went and got their driver's license, passed a little test and one thing to the other, and then they went back to do their driver's, what do you want to call it, and they got their driver's license. And that was so rewarding to them. But watch this, they had to be processed in it. They had to take the book and eat it. They had to study the book. Come on. And they was being processed in it because it wasn't nothing wrong with the car. The car just needs somebody to drive it. But you had to follow the rules and regulation according to the law. So the seed that you have in the ground is only going to respond to what heaven has already sanctioned. Amen. You got seed in the ground. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And God said that he will rebuke the devourer. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And that your trees won't bear fruit before it's time. Hallelujah. So we're getting ready to lift up our offering and get ready to get out of here. And we're excited about what the Lord is doing. We're going to stay right here in the season in terms of what God is saying. Amen. Amen. There's a shifting that has taken place. Amen. A shift have taken place. Praise God. Are you ready to give?